When it comes to being competitive at Pikes Peak, power and weight are key. And with 1150 horsepower and just a touch over 1100 kgs of weight, this E36 behind me should be a pretty potent competitor in the open class. Now we're here with Wayne from Bimmerworld, engineer behind this car, to find out a little bit about what makes it tick. So first of all, Wayne, why the decision to go with the E36 chassis? In terms of BMW heritage, that's actually now getting to be relatively dated. Maybe not in base form the most aerodynamic selection from the BMW stable. So what was the driving force there?
It's just a nostalgic kind of a thing because this, you know, when Bimmerworld started, these are the cars that they were selling parts for. And it's a favorite among the Bimmerworld crowd. So also, the older cars are a little smaller too, so a little less frontal area, but not any, you know, real strategic or performance reason, so yeah.
I guess when you're really starting to build a clean sheet car from the ground up with no limitations, then realistically the body shape doesn't end up being the biggest factor in the whole build?
Right, and you know, it's a little easier to pick up one of these cost-wise. We spent a lot on the build, but the car we started with didn't cost.
Pretty cost-effective based starting point. Now, interestingly though, there's not really a lot of BMW E36 left in it. I want to start with the chassis itself. So you've gone away from a factory-style monocoque chassis. You've gone to a complete tube chassis. So what was the driver behind that? Was that an essential aspect of being competitive in the open class?
So, oddly enough, the move to the tube chassis started with the engine. Originally, the car was going to be an inline six, which is what these cars came with, so it fits in there nicely. But we eventually decided to go with the V8, and the V8 sits on top of the frame rails. So
basically no way of fitting it with a stock chassis?
Yeah, no way to fit it with the frame rails and the struts from the original car. And so once we decided that we were going to have to cut off the frame rails and with the big tunnels under the car, it just kind of made sense to go to a tube chassis. We still do have the body is a real shell. The roof and quarter panels and all is still a metal shell.
Still components there?
Yep. But it does sit on top of a tube chassis, not just a roll cage. Yep.
Okay, so you just mentioned that engine, which is what I wanted to get into next. So, as you said, these came out in stock form with an inline six. So, you've now got a twin turbo V8. Can you tell us what was that engine sourced from? What is the engine itself?
So, it's the same, it's the P63 from the GT3 M6 BMW races in WeatherTech. And so, that's the race version of the S63, which comes in the M5 and the M6.
But this base engine actually started life as a GT3 race engine?
Yes. And Roush Engines has done a lot of work. I don't know all the internals, all the things they've done, but yes, they've done a lot of internal work. The GT3 series, they're making around 500 horsepower, give or take, and we're more than doubling that. So yeah.
Let's just go back on that, because in GT3 form, there's a variety of different cars running in the GT3 class, and to try and get some kind of balance of performance, one of the key aspects that they have available is the restrictor size. So that's how the power is restricted down to 500 horse. So straight away you get rid of those restrictors on the inlet, that's going to allow the engine to breathe, and you can make a lot more power. But of course then the next thing you come up against is the limitations of the factory turbochargers. Safe to assume that you've gone to a larger turbo here to make 1100 plus horsepower.
Yes, I don't know the specs on the turbos, but they were sourced from Weistec, and it's a bigger turbo. I don't know all the specs on the turbo. Roush worked with Weistec on that.
So in terms of keeping the engine reliable, again, at that sort of power level, you're talking double where they are at GT3, where they are well-proven and reliable. But this is a completely different ballpark. All right, so talking about the rest of that chassis, another key change you've made here, which is quite unique, is it's no longer running a gearbox straight off the back of the engine. So you've gone to a transaxle. Can you tell us a little bit about the decision behind that transaxle?
So it helps with the packaging because there's not a lot of room for the driver's feet, and so now we just have a drive shaft going to the back of the engine. It gives us a little more room in the cockpit. It's also nice for weight distribution. These cars can have a tendency to have more than 50% on the front axle, so transaxle puts some weight in the back. And with this particular transaxle, the gears are forward of the axle and below the axle, which is exactly where you would want to put the weight if you had a choice. So,
have you got an idea for what the finished weight split front to rear is going to be now with that transaxle?
We believe it's going to be really close to 50-50. We have weighed the car a number of times before it was completed to the point where it is now, and it was 50-50. Now, there were a few components missing at that time. We haven't weighed it since we've completed it, but we were under 2,500 pounds and right on 50-50 at the time, so should be really close. And if it's not 50-50, we can probably move a couple of things around and get it there.
Now, the other aspect that's really important to keep an engine like this reliable, and particularly at Pikes Peak with the high altitude, low air density, you lose a lot of cooling efficiency. So can you talk to us about the cooling package on the engine, how you've gone through the design of that in terms of both intercoolers as well as radiators for engine coolant, transmission, etc.?
So that's something that... So our fabricator, Rich Group, that's something that he worked really hard on. And there's a cooler in the back of the car for the gearbox. And because there's not a lot of room in the front, these cars were a little smaller than a 3 Series we have these days. So with the V8 and the wide tires, we're a little crowded for space up front. And so, but... it's got two radiators up front stacked in a V formation like that, just to get the surface area that we need. And then in front of each tire, the from top to bottom and the width of the tire is all intercooler on each side. And one intercooler for each 4 cylinders.
So in an interesting aspect as well, I mean, nothing particularly unique for a lot of the European manufacturers, but the configuration of that engine actually has the exhaust manifolds in the valley between the two banks of cylinders, and the inlet manifolds are off to the side, where conventionally we sort of tend to see that the other way around. So, I mean, does that help with your packaging in terms of the intercooler setup?
It worked out. You know, I've never worked with an engine that's laid out like that before. It worked out nicely. The charge pipes from the turbos come off the top of the engine and go forward to each corner of the car, and then the outlet of the intercoolers is on the bottom, and it's just you know, about 12 inches away from the intake manifolds. So
it keeps everything nice and short.
Yep. Kept everything nice and short, and all the heat is on the top. You know, heat's going to rise anyway, so all the heat's on the top of the motor. And yeah, it worked out really nice.
Now, in terms of the electronics package fitted to the car, that's obviously another key in order to make the sort of power that you're talking about. Obviously, boost control is critical, making sure those turbos are doing exactly what you want. And then you've got that pedal shifted Hollinger transaxle in the rear to control the shifting off. So what's the electronics controlling those, and what have you got for a driver display?
So the ECU is a Bosch Motorsport ECU, which we will use for the gearbox as well. And then for the display, it's a MoTeC display.
So you're using the MoTeC display for logging as well, or is that just purely a driver display?
For logging also. It's what we've typically used with our IMSA race cars, and we're used to it. We're used to the software, the way it presents data, and so, yeah, that's what.
Now, one of the key challenges with Pikes Peak is the altitude change. At the finish line, you're sort of 14,100 feet, give or take, and at that sort of altitude, your air density is incredibly low. So the problem with this is, of course, the engines lose power. With a turbocharged engine, you've got the ability to claw back some of that by basically pushing the turbos harder as you go up the hill climb. Are you going to be using sort of some compensations for barometric air pressure in order to try and maintain a relatively consistent power level in the car?
So I'm going to have to plead ignorance on that a little bit. I'm the chassis guy. We are hoping to be able to maintain power, but... I don't know all the ins and outs of the programming on the, you know, the ECU side of that.
I did notice there you've got turbo speed sensors on each turbo. That's generally one of the key inputs the calibration technicians are looking at. But as you say, you're in charge of the chassis, so I sort of put you on the spot, something outside of your normal area of expertise. So let's get back to something you're probably a bit more familiar with, though, the aero. It's hard to look at this car without going past the fact that the aero package on it is pretty amazing. So can you give us any numbers on what sort of downforce you're expecting developed from the car?
So the wing is rated for about 1,700 or 1,800 pounds of downforce. And so we have to balance that with downforce in the front of the car. The wing is a little bit behind the axle, so we'll have to balance it with something more, you know, whatever the numbers work out to. It's going to be about 2,000 pounds in the front.
And what sort of speed are you talking about getting that kind of downforce at?
I think the wing is rated for that downforce at 150 miles per hour.
It's not insignificant, specifically given the weight of the car. You sort of, yeah, definitely, well, and particularly with a rear-wheel drive car, when you're trying to make that sort of power as well, obviously getting that downforce is key to getting traction. Look, it's been really interesting getting some insight into the car. Obviously, it's a fresh build, so look forward to seeing how you go next year at Pikes Peak. Wish you all the best of luck.
Yep, thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.